This computer. Okay, the next topic that I'm going to talk today will be the most important things that you may have to know. That is the overview of the data structure course, right? So because this course is about the programming with data structures and algorithms, right? So you may have to know many things new in this course. Starting from, I will introduce you about the data structure. What does it mean? Or the classification of the data structure and also the operation on data structures. And sometimes data structure can be called abstract data type. So I'm going to talk about the meaning or the definition of the abstract data type. And algorithms. Let's say that in this course, we will talk about data structure and algorithms. So we have to know the meaning of the algorithms and the different approaches to design an algorithm. And the next one, I'm going to talk about the control structure using algorithms. And the most important part that you have to know in this course, that is the time and space complexity. And you have to know how to measure the efficiencies of the algorithms by using big O notation. Okay, this will be all the topics that we have to focus on today. And it will be just the overview and the lovely idea. Only time and space complexity and big O notation will go into detail. Okay, first of all, I have to start from the introduction or the basic terminology in data structure. Our aim has been to design good programs, right? So what does it mean by good program? Good program is a program that can run correctly, easy to read and understand, easy to debug, and the last one, it is easy to modify. Okay, so a program should give correct result, okay? But along with that, it should also run efficiently. So this is a terminology that you need to keep in mind, that when you are trying to design good programs, it need to be correct, readable, understandable, debuggable, and modifiable. And once again, it has to run efficiently. When we talk about a program, it's said to be efficient when it can execute in minimum time and with minimum memory storage or memory space. So in order to write an efficient program, we need to apply certain data structure or certain data management concept. So the concept of data management is a complex task that includes activity like data collection, organization of the data into appropriate data structures, and developing and maintaining routines for quality assurance. So this is the concept of the data management concept, right? You need to data correction, you have to organize the data, we call data structure, and then the quality assurance for the development and maintenance routine for the algorithm or the program has to be considered, okay? And the next topic, that is, what does it mean by data structure? I always tell you that when I'm trying to explain something, right, I need to explain it what, why, and how, right? So what does it mean by data structure, or what is data structure? A data structure is a group of data elements, right, that are put together under one name. For example, student, you have the names, family name, ID name, ID, faculty name, department name. Then we group the data and elements, right, into the same name or into one name, that is a student information. Okay, and which defines a particular way of storing and organizing data in a computer so that it can be used efficiently. Okay, we can see this word again, efficiently. Okay. Data structure are used in almost every program or software system. Okay, and in this course, right, we are going to deal with these kinds of data structure, starting from arrays, linked lists, QSAT binary tree hash table graph many things, right? This is some examples of the data structure that we are going to study this term, okay? Together with the algorithm that appropriate for this kind of data structure. Okay, what and why? Okay, why? Why do we have to use the data structure? We can use the data structure in many applications in the wide area. For example, compiler design, statistically analysis package, numerical analysis, or even for AI operating system that I have talked about, DBMS, the database management system, or in the program simulation, or the last one would be computer graphics and game programming. They all need the data structure in order to be used for writing a complex program. So this is why we have to know about the concept of the data structure. Mm-hmm. Okay, for example, when you will study the BMS, database management system as a subject, you will realize that the major data structure to be used in, like network data model will be graph, hierarchical data model will be tree, relational database management system is array. These are some examples of mapping applications and the data structure on the right hand side. Specific data structure are essential ingredients in many efficient algorithms. Right? When we talk about data structure, we also talk about the efficient algorithm. We need to make the algorithm more efficient if you select an appropriate data structure. They enable the programmers to manage huge amounts of data easily and efficiently. Okay, once again, we have to quote the word easily and efficiently by using data structure. Okay, this is why. Why do we have to use data structure? We want to use data structure for many kinds of application and want to create an algorithm. And that algorithm needs to be efficient. In a particular problem, you may come up with many algorithm, many kinds of algorithm, many kinds of data structure, but the most efficient and easy to use algorithm will be used. Okay, and the note, the last one will be some formal design methods and programming languages emphasize on data structures and the algorithm. This is the key organizing factor in software design. Okay, this is the important word. For some formal design method, okay, I've just told you that we emphasize on data structure and algorithm, right? This is the key organizing factor in software design. This is because representing information or data, right? This one is a fundamental to computer science or computer applications. When you want to write a program, right? The first thing that you need to be concerned that is a data structure or data. Right, you have to keep data, you have to collect data, and how can we manage this data efficiently? You can use data structure, but the data structure that you can use it efficiently, you need to concern about the application or the algorithm as well. So the primary goal of program or software is not to perform calculation or operation only, but also to store and retrieve information as fast as possible. Okay? This is the key concept, right? When you talk about the program and software, right? You can just need to perform the correct calculation operations, but also you need to run it fast and efficiently, right? Run what? Store and retrieve information. So this is the reason why we have to use data structure. You have to use an appropriate data structure for a particular application. This is a keyword. Okay, what and why and how. If a program meets its performance goals with a data structure that is simple to use, then make it no sense to apply another complex data structure, right? Just to exhibit the programmer's skills. Okay, when you come up with the easier one, right? Maybe the more complex one or the more complicated one can be used, right? If you want to improve the programmer skills. When selecting the data structure to solve problem, the following step must be performed. We have three steps, right? After we select the data structure, the first one is you have to analyze the problem. Analyze the problem is to determine the basic operations that must be supported. For example, basic operation may be inserting, deleting, searching a data item from tree. You can insert a node to tree, you can delete a node from tree, you can search tree, right? This is the problem or the operation that will be used in the data structure. The second one is quantifying the resource constraints for each operation, right? For each operation, it needs to be as fast as possible, right? I have told you, right? So you need to quantify the resource constraints. And the last one, select the data structure that best meets this requirement. Best meet this requirement. Okay, so I would say that if you want to develop a program like what's that? ATM machine, right? What kind of data structure will be used for collecting the customer information? You can also use array. You can use linked list, okay? But both of them are linear search, right? If you want to search the data, right? If you have just only 10 customers, it's easier. It's very easy, pretty easy. But let's think about the database for the banking system. The database is not just 10 items. You may have to search for 10 or 1,000 million accounts, right? Within 1 minute, one second, right? What shall we do? If you use a data structure like array or linked list, it's not possible, it's impossible. So the data structure that's going to be used in here supposed to be tree, right? A binary tree, right? That will, the search engine will be, or the complexity of the search engine will be log n or something, right? It will be pretty fast, right? So the data structure is important, right? If you select the wrong data structure, your program will be in trouble, I would say that. So this is the reason why we have to study the data structure, okay? You know, CVE 112 is important. So please, the next topic is the elementary data structure organization. Data structures are building blocks of a program. A program built using improper data structure may not work as expected. Okay, this one I have already told you, right? If you select a wrong data structure, you will be come up with the slow software or application. As a programmer, it is compulsory to choose most appropriate data structure for a program. So learning this subject, after you complete this subject or this course, you have to know how to choose an appropriate data structure that is suitable for a program. Okay, this is a learning outcome. Okay, and the next, the term data means a value or set value, right? It specifies either the value or variable or constants, okay? Why a data item that does not have subordinate data item is categorized as an elementary item. So what I'm going to say is that we also have the data structure and elementary data structure. Right. What does it mean by elementary item? Elementary item means there is no details about that item. Right. Let's say if it cannot be composed of one or more subordinate data items, we call a group them. group item. For example, a student name may be divided into three sub items: first name, middle name, and last name. Okay, this one is a complex item, but elementary item will be only the first name, only the middle name, and last name. Okay. And from the data, elementary data, complex data, we can go up, come up with a record. A record is a collection of data items, collection of data items or primitive data item. For example, the name, address, course, and marks, right, obtained by individual data item can be grouped together into one record of the student information. And if you have many records, right, you can collect them into a file. But a file is a collection of related records. For example, if there are 60 students in the class, or in this class, 80 students, right, then there are 60 records for the student. Okay, this is an example of the records. And then we can keep all these records into the same file, into one file, right? You can store in a file. Similarly, we can have a file of all the employees, right, working in an organization, and a file of the customer company, a file of all the suppliers, and so on. Okay, this is a file. So now we have known about, we have studied about value, data item, record, file. Okay, this is the terminology in the data structure. Okay, this is the next topic about the how can we classify the data structure. We can classify the data structure into two classes, primitive and non-primitive. Pretty easy. Primitive data structure in a programming language will be integer, character, boolean, real, right? Character, integer, floating point. Okay, sometimes we can call data type, sometimes we can call basic data type or primitive data type. We can always use them interchangeably. When we have primitive data type or data structure, we also have the user-defined data structure, or we can call non-primitive data structure. This data structure will be created by using the primitive data structure, and we can combine them into one new data structure. Or sometimes we can call user-defined data structure. Some examples of such data structure included linked lists, stacks, trees, graphs, and so on. These are the list of the things that we have to understand and study in this term. And also for the non-primitive, data structure can be also classified into two types, right? Linear one and non-linear. Linear means you have to access it one after another, but non-linear, you can randomly access to this data structure. This is the simple meanings of these two kinds of data structure, right? If the elements of the data structure are stored in a linear or sequential order, like array, right? Like linked list or stack or queue, right? This will be called linear data structure. Linear data structure can be represented in memory in two different ways. The first one is linear relationship between elements by means of sequential memory location. Memory location, for example, array. Array, you have to allocate the contiguous item or contiguous memory location. It has to be close to each other, right? But in the other way is the linear relationship. Right, it is an element that can be connected by the links together. So the address of this, of each node, they are not to be the contiguous the nodes, right? It can be linked by the link. And the next one is the non-primitive, often the non-primitive data structure is non-linear, right? Non-linear, what does it mean by non-linear data structure? It means that the relationship of adjacency is not maintained, right, between elements of the nonlinear data structure. It's randomly placed into different places in the main memory. So, but they can link by using the pointer that we have already talked in the previous module, right? Some examples of the nonlinear data structure in this case is trees and graphs. Okay, today I will go briefly and show you the idea of each data structure that we are going to study in this course, right? We start from array, linked list, tree, graph, and then we are, okay, that is very important that you have that to know, okay? The first one, array. What does it mean by array? Array is a set of the same data elements. I mean, similar data elements, but the same data type. Okay, the same data type can be kept in an array. The elements of the array are stored in consecutive memory locations and are referenced by an index, as we know, subscript. Okay, in this example, you can see that if you define the marks is a variable array of integer of 10 integers. So you will have to define 10 contiguous elements, right? From the first element to the 10th element. But if in C program, right, you need to access to these elements by using mask 1 for the first element, mask subscript 0 for the first element, mask subscript 1 for the second element, and so on. So you can see that the subscript will be the rank or the place of the element -1. Right? This is the way that C program does array. Why do we have to use array? Array are fixed size. Array are generally used when we want to store a large amount of similar data type, right? But this is the cons for array, right? This is the limitation. The first one is array, the number of the array's item will be fixed, right? Data element are stored in the contiguous memory location. Have to continue, right? If you want to declare 100 integer, right? You need to find the contiguous memory location, right? But if you need 10,000 integer, right, you need the contiguous memory location for 10,000 bytes. That would be a bit more difficult to find, right? And insertion and deletion of elements is problematic, can cause a problem because of the shifting elements from their position. If suppose you insert an element in between, right, you need to shift the rest one step further and then copy the value to the correct place. This is an insertion. But if you want to delete an element, right, you need to delete and then shift the rest or the remaining array back to the right place. That would be problem. So the array is not the answer for the sophisticated applications. We need an array to prove of concept. If you want to start the program, right, maybe you can use the array for the smaller number of test cases, right? You can use array. But when you have the bigger number of test cases, you may have to change array to other kinds of the data structure. Okay, then we are going to talk into detail about this later, but array is a simple one, right? You can use array because we have already studied C programming and array is supposed to be the things that we use or we use. In order to solve the previous problem that I've told you, right? That is about the fixed size or insertion delete problems, you can use a linked list. What does it mean by linked list? Linglist is a very, very flexible and dynamic data structure. You can keep it into what we call a sequential list. Okay, I will show you the figure that you can have an idea of how to use the linked list. Okay, normally if you use the array, right, everything will be have to be close to each other. It's a consecutive memory location. This is a fixed and not flexible. But for linked list, right, you can, okay, this is there are 7 items and you use one. This part, the first part will be the value of the node. And this one will be the link to the next value. Okay, in this case, like if you want to manage this one, it will be more flexible comparing to the case of the array. Okay, so this is the way of linked list does. Okay, come back to the definition. In contrast to the static array, a program need not to worry about how many elements to be stored in the list, because it could be insert into the linked list as much as you want according to the maximum limit of the memory memory location. But you can add elements to the linked list always. So this feature enables the programmers to write robust programs which require less maintenance. Okay, it's require the flexible number of input. In a linked list, like each node is a located space as it is added to the list. Okay, so every node in the linked list to the next node in the list, that we call the node, right? The value of the node, right? And you have two parts. I've just told you, right? There are two types of the data for the linked list. The first one is the value of the nodes, and the second one is a pointer or link to the next node. To the next node in the list, okay? And the last node in the list contain what we call null pointer. You can also use this null, right, in C programming to represent the null pointer or the end pointer here. If you want to end up this linked list, right, you can use NULL and set it to be the pointer to the last item in the linked list. Sometimes we can call the end or tail of the linked list. Since the memory for a node is dynamically allocated, when it is added to the list, the total number of nodes that may be added to the list is limited only by the amount of memory available. Only amount of memory available is the limitation of the linked list. So it means that you can add up many items as you want, as long as the memory is available. So I want to summarize here, that is the advantage of the linked list. Advantage of the linked list will be, it is easier to insert and delete data elements. But if you have advantage, we also have the disadvantage. Disadvantage of the linked list will be slow search operation and requires more memory space. Because linked list is a sequential data structure. So if you want to insert the last place in this link, oh my God, you have to go to end items and then add up at the n plus one location. This is a slow search operation and allows more memory space, right? Because you need to have more memory space in order to keep the link or the pointer to the next list or to the next link. Okay, so this is the additional memory space that you need to use to be used for the linked list. Okay, up to now, do you have any questions about the linked list? Okay, if you have no question, I will have to explain you about the next one. This is, do you know stack? Stack. Stack is something like if you place something on top of something as a stack of plates, right? Stack is also a linear data structure in which insertion and deletion of elements will be done only one end. What does it mean? I don't have the the how to explain the stack, right? Suppose I have the mobile, right? This is a stack, right? The first stack, where they put, right? Stack is called last in, first out. The concept of this data structure is last in, first out because the last element which is added to this stack. Suppose this is one, the first element, the second element, the third element. If the stack means if you want to take out the last element, you have to take out this one first, and this one second, and this one is the third one. So the last element which is added to the stack is the first element to be deleted from the stack. Do you get the point? This is the concept of the stack. Okay, so you can see this figure, right? In the stack implementation here, you add A to the stack, and then add B to the stack, C and D and E. So now the top of stack is E. When you want to pop something out, okay, in stack, if you want to get a value or an item from the stack, you need to use pop function. Pop function will get an element E, the value E from the stack, and then it will reduce E or eliminate E from the stack, and then you can get A, B, C, D in your stack. This is the way that the stack does, right? Every stack has a variable top, right? Top of stack, right? To check that this is the top of stack. And top of stack will not be more than the number max, okay? Max will be the topmost of the stack. If you are trying to insert something to the max of stack, it's not possible. It will show you your stack is full. Okay? But if top stack is now and you're trying to pop something out, right? It's not possible, right? So the empty stack empty is printed out. This is the way. Okay, you have heard many operations for this stack data structure. There are three basic operations for stack. Push. What does it mean by push? Push is to add an element to the top of stack. Suppose we have the top of stack here. Push and push and push. Okay. But if you want to remove the element from the stack, you can use pop operation. Pop, pop, and pop. Okay. This is push and pop. And pip operation. Pip operation will return the value of the topmost element of the stack without deleting it. Pip operation is to return the value of the topmost without deleting it. Okay. Okay, this is a special occasion, right? However, when you trying maybe for inserting an element to the stack, right? You have to check for the overflow condition. If the overflow condition occurs, so you cannot push the stack because it is already full. Similarly, if you want to delete a stack, an element from the stack, right? Before deleting, you must check for the underflow condition. And underflow condition occurs when you are trying to delete a stack from the empty stack. So you have to return stack is empty. So it's not possible to pop the stack, okay? This is the condition that you have to keep in mind, that you have to check before you push and pop from the stack. Otherwise, you will be in trouble. Okay, the previous one is about the concept of the stack, LIFO, last in, first out. Last in, first out, we call LIFO, right? Stack is LIFO. Or last in, first out, LIFO. But for the queue, right? Queue will be first in, first out. Queue will perform the FIFO manner, right? First in, first out, not like a queue. Okay, this data structure, the first element that inserted, it will be the first one to be taken out. So this is a common sense. And you need to delete the first part of the queue, right? So like that, queue can be implemented by using array or linked list. Array and linked list. Okay. Okay, this is some example of the queue. So queue, you have to maintain the front and the rear, right? Front will be the first element that will be deleted. Okay, if you delete it, it will be the front will be moved to the next element. So this is the way that you want to implement the queue by using array, right? You need to have the control variable front and rear to point the location that is the front and the rear respectively. Okay, that's all for the step and queue, right? The next data structure that is very useful and very efficient will be the tree, right? I've told you that for stack array, when you use array for stack or queue, right? They are the linear data structure. So if you want to access to it, you need to use the sequential operations. But for a tree, right, it's not a linear data structure, right, which consists of a collection of nodes. Let's think about the tree, right? We have tree, you have the branch and the leaf, right? You can think of the leaf as a node. And we have the root node, right? And root node will contain or partition into two disjoint sets, right? That is subtree. If we have two sides of the tree, we can say that it is a binary tree, right? A binary tree consists of root and left subtree and right subtree only. Right, that's why we call binary tree by means two. Two binary trees mean there are two branches from the root. Okay, let's see this example. This example is a binary tree, right? This is a root. Root, you will have two subtree, T1 and T2. Two is the root of the T1 subtree, right? Containing 4, 5, 8, 9. And T2 will be the right subtree of this root R, right? We have the root is which is tree. A binary tree consists of a root node, left root node, right? Left node and right subtree, right? Both subtrees are also binary trees, okay? The root element is the topmost node. The root element will be the topmost node, which is pointed by a root, right? Root pointer. If root is equal to null, then the tree is empty. Okay, first of all, when you initialize a root, right, you have to set the root to null. Once you insert some item into the root, right, it will be okay, it's not null or not empty. So the advantage of using tree is it provides a quick search, insert, and delete operation. Okay, I'm going to talk about this later in the next class. And disadvantage of tree is complicated deletion algorithm, right? If you want to delete if you want to delete leaf node, right? It's not difficult, but if you want to delete two, right? Which is the inner node. If you want to delete inner node, it would be difficult. You need a special algorithm in order to use for delete a node from the tree. And the next important data structure that you have to use, and this one is also very popular, that is a graph. Graph is also a nonlinear data structure, right? Which is a collection of vertices, also called node. And edges that connect these vertices. From this example, the list of vertices will be A, B, C, D, and E. And edges, like the set of edges, will be AD, AB, DB, DE, EC, BC, right? This we call the edge. The edges that will connect two vertices. A graph is built by a generalization of tree structure. Actually, graph is a generalization of the tree, right? Where instead of purely parent to child relationship, right? For the node, right? The node in tree, right? This is a parent has two child, two children, right? T1 and T2, right? This is a parent and child relationship, but there is no parent and child relationship in graph, right? Only node, right? At edge, right? Then we will connect in to form the graph. A tree structure node can have any number of children, but only one parent. But a graph, on the other hand, relaxes all such kinds of restriction. Okay, for the tree, right? That's why graph is a generalization of tree. Tree structure is a specification of graph. Why do we have to use graph? What is the representation of graph in the real world application? In the real world application, right? A node in the graph may represent a city and the edge. Connecting the node or the city can represent road. Okay, so you can represent these kinds of the graph to be the map, right? If you want to go from city A to city B, right? So you can represent it like this, like graph, right? And you may put the distance from A to B, right, to the edge of the graph. That's possible. A graph can also be used to represent a computer network. In the field of computer network, right, graph will be used, always used. Okay, I need to use the word always, where the nodes are workstation and the edge are the network connections. Okay, it can be noted that unlike tree, graph does not have any root node. You can start from any node in graph. Every node in the graph can be connected with every other another node in the graph. And when two nodes are connected via an edge, right, the two nodes are known as neighbor. For example, what are the neighbors of B? The neighbor of B will be two nodes connected by an edge. So the neighbor of E will be of B will be A, D, and C. That will be the neighbor of B because there is an edge that connect B to A, D, and C respectively. So in order to conclude the graph, right, the advantage of using graphs is it is the best model real world application or real world situation. For example, the DISA algorithm, if you want to find the shortest path from one city to another city, right, you can represent it as a graph. Okay, we are going to talk about this application when we are studying graph, right, later. But disadvantage of using graph is some algorithms are slow and very complex. Okay, that's possible because if you have, okay, this one you have, there are just only 5 nodes. But let's think about the real world application. If you want to design the system of BTS SkyTrain, okay, you need to connect the route or the route from one station to another station, right? But there are how many stations are there in Bangkok SkyTrain system? More than 20 stations, right? So if you have n is more than or equal to 20, right, your program or your system will be very complex and slow to implement. But 20 is okay. But let's think about the airline ticket reservation, right? You need to connect like many, many cities in the world, right? Okay, and when we talk about data structure, if you could remember, right, we have to talk about the operation on data structure as well. For example, for the stack, right, we have push, pop, and peep, right? This is operation on specific data structure. And there will be some of the operation on data structure. For example, the traversing will be used for the tree and graph, like tree traversing. What does it mean by traversing? Traversing means to access each data item exactly once, right? So that it can be processed. Okay, searching is to find the location that a particular items do you want in your data structure. Inserting, deleting is to insert and delete the item from the form N into the data structure. So sorting, right? We may have to study about the sorting algorithm later, right? Sorting is to reorganize or arrange your item or your data in ascending order or descending order. And merging. Merging means if you have two lists of sorted data items, you want to merge them into the sorted data item as well. What shall we do, right? So this is the way that this operation on the data structure that you may have to understand and implement, okay? There is a question from TO, right? We will also see the oriented graph. What does it mean? I don't know. I have no idea about oriented graph. Maybe I will check it out and I will tell you later. Is that okay? Okay, let me try to finish the abstract data type and then we'll have a short break, okay? Because abstract data type is is very similar or familiar with the concept or the terminology of the data structure. Abstract data type, sometimes we can use interchangeably with the data structure, but ADT or abstract data type is the way we look at the data structure, but we focus only what it does and ignoring how it does its job. Okay. For example, if you are considering stack and queue, right? If you want to implement stack and queue, right? You can implement it and then you can use array or linked list, right? This is a demonstration of abstract nature of stack and queue. But you have to also implement it, right? You can ignore it. For the abstract data type, you can ignore it. You can just know that if you want to insert, you can use push. If you want to delete from the stack, you can use pop. To further understanding the meaning of the abstract data type, we will break the term into data type and abstract. Okay, what does it mean by abstract? Okay, starting from data type of a variable is a set of value. Right, that is that the variable can take. Okay, when we talk about the data type, we have to think about the primitive data type, character, integer, floating point, and so on, or double. Right, this is the basic data type in C. Right, we also have to think about the. Okay, when we talk about a primitive type or built-in data type, we actually consider two things. The first one is a data item with certain characteristics and the permissible operation on the data. Okay, when we talk about integer, right, you have to think about the range of the value of integer. Let's say -3,2768 to 3,2767, right? This is the range of this the value that the possible value for the integer value. But you need to have to add up with the operation on this integer value. For example, add, minus, times, and divide. Okay, these operators will be used for the integer value. Okay, this is a way that we think about the data type. When we think about data type, we need to think about the range of the value and the operation on the value. Other than the name and the type and the address of the in memory. Okay, this is a data type. And the term abstract, what does it mean by abstract? I always ask the student, what does it mean by abstract? The Thai student will say, abstract is an abstract. Abstract is abstract. What does it mean by abstract? I don't know. What does it mean by abstract? What is the context of the context of data structure?
Hiding the details, like the complicated details.
Again, please.
Like hiding the complicated details.
Hide the complicated details, right? So you don't need to know how to implement. Or you have to know how to implement. Or you can just know what to implement.
Like, just know what it is used for.
Okay. I understand your point. Okay, that's right. Abstract, normally when you talk about abstract, right, it means that you are going to think about it. Like, for example, like there are many students in this class, 80 students. What is an abstract? Because I don't know you into detail, right? But when I call, okay, Pichayapha, okay, this is a name, right? I specify you as a name, right? So this is a kind of abstract. I don't have to know what is your face, what is PCR face, eyes, nose? No, I don't know. I have to know, okay, this one is a student called Pichayapha, right? This is abstract, okay? So when you talk about the abstract, right, you have to consider only some important part, that apart from the, you will ignore the detail, specification or implementation. So in programming, right, when you talk about the abstract data type, so you will talk about like stack, you will just think about the attribute inside the app, the stack, and the operation on that stack. For example, push, pop, and peep. In C, an abstract data type can be a structure or data structure. Consider it without regard to its implementation. Can you show me about the abstract data type or abstract things in C? Struct, structure, declaration. Am I right? Structure declaration is also an abstract data type. Okay, without saying about the description or the detail of the data structure. And it can be thought of and of as a description of the data in the data structure with a list of operation. Okay, for example, the stack is a good example. Okay, so this is the meaning of abstract. Okay, we have already talked about the example of stack and queue, right? For stack and queue, right, the user is concerned that only with the data type and the operation that can be performed on it. You don't have to know about how to implement the stack. But in C program, right, you need to implement the stack or queue by yourself. But in Java, the Java and C are similar. When you use Java for implementing stack, you don't have to do anything, right? You can just simply import the stack and queue, right? And then you can use push pop, right, according to the operation or the methods that already decided for the stack and queue in Java library already. Okay. The fundamental of how the data is stored should be invisible to user. This is the key of the abstract. The user doesn't have to know about how to implement the data or to know the data, right? They should not be concerned with how the method work or what structures are being used to store the data. If you ignore about this, designing a program is much easier, right? They should just know that to work with stack, right? They have push and pop function. That's all. Okay, you can just simply push or get or push that is to insert an item to the stack, right? But ignoring the implementation. That is about, this is the meaning about abstract in abstract data type. And why do we have to use the abstract data type? In the real world, program involves as a result of new requirements or constraints. So suppose you write a program, right, and you finish this job, and then you are going to create the new job, right? And these two jobs are very similar, right? So you can have many new requirements and constraints for the new jobs. But so a modification to a program commonly requires change in one or more its data structure. So two different projects, there we have something in common and we have something that's different, but always they are always common. Right? If you implement like a web application, right, insert, update, delete are similar. Just only the data or the component inside will be different. So why do we have to write a new program every time you have to get the new requirement? So in this way, we have used abstract data type in order to deal with this concept, right? So you can just simply use the same structure of programming. You can also use push pop, that is, but different projects, you may need to use different kinds of the data structure. But data structure, we have some like insert, delete, update functions that are similar, right? That's why we have to use the abstract data type. In such a scenario, rewriting every procedure that uses the change structure is not desirable. It's not desirable. So a better alternative is to separate the use of data structure from the details of its implementation. Separate the use of the data structures, right? You can just simply use the same operation name, right? With different data structure, but you can just import different data structure. It's like a Lego, right? You push this, you don't want this module, right? It's like a car, right? If you want this engine, you don't need the primitive engine, right? You take it out and then you push the better or faster engine into the new one. This is the kinds of the abstract data type, right? The whole structure are the same, right? But inside will be changed, will be different in the implementation. This is the principle underlying the concept of abstract data type. Do you get my point? Because it's abstract as its name, right? Sometimes you don't understand exactly about what does it mean by abstract. But let's think about like this, like blurry, seeing into these things. So you can just simply think about it in the whole structure and don't think about it into the detail. Okay. Similarly, for the case of the AADT, right? Algorithms are also important in data structures. If you can see that this course name is Programming with Data Structure. And this book, the textbook here, is Data Structure and Algorithms. Data Structure and Algorithms. When you talk about the data structure, you need to implement it to a specific or the corresponding algorithm. What does it mean by algorithm? I think I don't have to go into details about the name. What does it mean by algorithms? I think all of you will know about the meaning or the description of the algorithms, right? It is a formal way to describe or to performing some calculation, right? And if you want to, it is formally defined that, but if you want to implement it according to the programming languages, right? In general terms, an algorithm provides a blueprint to write a program to solve the particular problem. Okay, so we can think about the algorithm as a formal method or formal details of the programs, right? But the programs will be implemented according to the programming languages to be used. That's all. So it is considered to be an effective procedure for solving a problem in finite number of steps. Okay, this has to be the keyword for the algorithm is to solve a problem and in finite step. Okay, and that is a well-defined algorithm always provide an answer and it's guaranteed that to be terminated, to terminate or to be terminated. Okay, otherwise it will be how or it will be a non-deterministic algorithm or program. Algorithm will be used to achieve a software reuse, okay? And if you have an idea or a blueprint of a solution, you can implement in a higher level language like C, C++, or Java. And once again, an algorithm is a set of instructions to solve the problem, okay? We need to start from the algorithm because I want to tell you about two different approaches to the design of algorithms. The first one is, or there are two kinds of algorithms, or two kinds of approach. The first one is top-down approach, and the second one is the bottom-up approach. Okay, I will talk about this into detail in the next slide. But before we go that page, right? Different approaches. Algorithms are used to manipulate the data contained in data structure. When working with data structure, algorithms are used to perform operation on the stored data. Okay, we have the data contained in the data structure, and then we have algorithm in order to perform this the operation on the data or on the stored data. A complex algorithm can be divided into a smaller part we call modules. And this process of dividing an algorithm into modules will be called modularization. Modularization, okay? It's important. And the key advantage of modularization is, the first one is to make a complex system or algorithm to be simple to design and implement. And the second one is each module can be decided independently. So you can manage the project into different smaller parts, and then you can give to the programmers the correct job to the correct person or correct programmer. By designing one module, the details of other modules can be ignored, thereby enhancing clarity in design, which is in turn simplifies implementation, debugging, testing, documenting, and maintenance of the overall program. So when you are trying to solve a smaller problem for one programmer, it would be easier than to design or to implement a bigger module, right? If you subdivide it into the smaller module, it would be easier to maintain and to program. Okay, I've just told you about the two main approaches of the designing algorithm, top-down approach. What does it mean by top-down approach? Top-down approach is very easy, right? When you have a big project, you subdivide them into the smaller project or smaller modules, and then you can give them each module, right, to different programmers. Top-down design method is a form of stepwise refinements. The name, right, called a form of stepwise refinement, right, where we begin with the topmost module and incrementally add modules that it calls. So in a top-down approach, we start from an abstract design, and then at each step, right, this design will refine it into more concrete level. For this example, this is a complex algorithm. For top-down approach, right, it will be separated into three modules or n modules. The first module can be divided into three modules. Second module will be divided into three modules. But this three module will be three concrete solutions. Yeah. More concrete level. So this one is concrete level, concrete solution. Once you can solve this problem, so module one will be solved, right? And this one, smaller module has been solved. So the module two will be solved. Once all module, n modules here can be solved, the complex in algorithm will be solved. So the concept of the top-down design will start from the complex problem or abstract problem, subdivided it into smaller problem, and then go to the level of the concrete solution. Okay, this is why we call a form of stepwise refinement. On the contrary to the bottom-up approach, we will do the different thing. It's just the reverse of top-down approach. In top-down design, bottom-up design, right? We start with the designing the most basic or concrete module, and then proceed by combining them together. Okay. Process towards designing higher level modules by combining or integrating, right? The higher level modules are implementing by using the operation performed by lower level modules. So in this approach, submodules are grouped together into the form of higher level module. From this picture, right, submodule will be grouped to module one. Submodule here will be grouped to module two and so on, right? And submodule one, two, three, to n will be grouped into the complex algorithm. This is the way that the bottom up, as it named, right, will do from the bottom line, bottom concrete level, and then combine them into the higher level and then to the complete solution. So this process is repeated until the design of the complete algorithm is obtained. Okay, bottom-up approach is different on the in the reverse of the top-down approach. Okay, if you want to compare about top-down and bottom-up approaches, okay, I have already summarized into this slide. Although the bottom-up, okay, while top-down approach follow a stepwise refinement by decomposing the algorithm into manageable module, the bottom-up approach, on the other hand, define a module that then group together several modules to form a higher new level module. This is the way of the top-down and bottom-up approach do. Top-down approach is highly appreciated for ease in documenting module, because from the top-down design, right, the abstract level of the module will be set up and then subdivide into smaller module. So it will be easier to documenting. Generating for test case or implementation of code and debugging will be easier. However, it's also criticized because the submodule are analyzed into in isolation without concentrating on their communication with other modules. Okay, bottom up means if you have submodule, right, but they are not communicated to each one, it can cause the problem later because the communication with other modules are not concentrated, right? On usability of components, a little attention is paid to data. Okay, so then, so this one will ignoring the concept of the information hiding. The next one is also the bottom up approach around information hiding. Okay, for the bottom-up approach, we allow information hiding as it first identifies what has to be encapsulated into a module, and then provides the abstract interface to define the module boundaries as seen from the clients. Okay, bottom-up will allow the information hiding. Information hiding, you will see this topic again in Java programming or object-oriented programming. But all this is difficult to be done in a strict bottom-up strategy. Some top-down activity need to be performed on this. So it's up to you, right? You can use a top-down or bottom-up approaches, right? It depends on the type of the application that you are going to use. If you want, okay, normally you are familiar with the top-down approach because you can think about the overall or the big picture of the system and then subdivide into the smaller part, and then you try to implement the smaller part and tackle all of them. But for the bottom up, right, you can just have many, many concrete things, right? And then you pick up this one, this one, this one to combine to one encapsulated module. The bottom up concept will be used in object-oriented programming. You will have many kinds of operation. You can have many kinds of attributes. You will form the object class, okay? And then from object class, it can be combined into the whole program. That is supposed to be the concept of the bottom-up approach. Okay. Shall we have a break for a while? I'm a bit tired.